this is a classical subject. I consider these numbers and the generating number function for these numbers as a very nice model for some models of mathematical physics. I will show that these functions has many nice integrable properties, like Virasoro equations, evolution equation, KP hierarchy, topological recursion, and so on. All similar properties share many functions appearing in matrix models and Gromov-Witten theory. So what's the advantage for Hurwitz numbers that is that in this case we can compute, this is quite elementary object, so we can compute this quite explicitly, and it provides a nice tool for making computer experiments. So just to see how all this stuff appear in mathematical physics. So the definition is as follows. In the simplest way, the Hurwitz numbers enumerate factorizations in the symmetric group. So let me denote, let me have an integer m and a partition. So the corresponding Hurwitz number is the number of sequences of M transpositions such that the product has cyclic type prescribed by the partition. So it means that it is a permutation which has cycles, independent cycles of length lambda 1, lambda 2, and so on, lambda n. Besides, we require one more condition, so-called simple sometimes it's more convenient to have one more requirement, that the requirement that the condition one applies one condition of connectedness, which means that the group generated by all these transpositions acts transitively. On the set of permuted elements. In another version, the Hurwitz numbers enumerate ramified coverings of a sphere. Consider Riemann sphere and consider a meromorphic function which takes values in this complex numbers, and the meromorphic function could be viewed as a ramified covering on some Riemann curve C. Any genus, right? Then I will say, so that the critical, this is a ramified covering which ramifies over the critical points. If we assume that all finite critical points are simple, then the corresponding monodromy group, when we go around the critical value, is just a permutation. And besides, we can assume that this function has ramification at infinity, which corresponds to the poles of this meromorphic function, and these ramifications over infinity or order of poles are given by this partition. So we have m preimages of infinity with given orders of poles. Then essentially enumeration of these factorizations is the same as the enumeration of meromorphic functions with prescribed values of critical values. Because if we know this factorization, then we know the monodromy of this covering, and then the curve could be recovered uniquely. So the genus, you ask about the genus is related to the enumerative data by the Riemann-Hurwitz formula. So it doesn't matter if we fix the number of simple critical values, the same as to fix the genus. So let me make some small change of notation, so it would be more convenient for me to fix the genus rather than the number of critical values. Besides, let me put here a combinatorial factor, which just a matter of notation. So this condition is equivalent that the curve is irreducible, right? So let me compose all these numbers into a generating function. So that these numbers are just Taylor coefficients of this expansion. And similar for this one. For disconnected Hurwitz numbers, and by a simple combinatorial observation, the second one is the exponent of the former one. So this is a function that we are studying, and the one of the main properties, I will erase the definition. That this H is a solution to KP hierarchy, or which is equivalent that its exponent is a Kp tau function. So this is a just simplest case of simple usual Hurwitz numbers. This theory has a lot of ramifications. Let me recall them. There are simple Hurwitz numbers. There are also so-called monotone. Also, there are different variations. There is so-called Bousquet-Melou-Schaeffer functions and numbers. Or also maps, hypermaps. And so on. So these variations just responsible for different other different properties of the different conditions on the factorization in the symmetric group. For instance, for the case of monotone numbers, we consider also factorizations into permutations. Such that in the case of monotone numbers, we require that each permutation is each transposition here permutes two numbers A and B that we order, for instance, in this way. And the monotone factorization means that the greatest number B go in the increasing order. For instance, in the case of Bousquet-Melou-Schaeffer numbers, we do not impose any requirement on tau I. Again, we consider similar factorizations such that tau I is just not necessarily permutation, just any permutation. Then we only impose the requirement that the corresponding covering surface given by this data is connected and has a prescribed genus, or which is the same that the total number of cycles in this M permutations is fixed.
There is no lambda.
No
lambda, just number of
cycles. No, lambda is encoded in the cyclic type of sigma. And these are just any permutation. Among them, there could be just identity permutation. In the standard one, these are necessarily transpositions. For simple Hurwitz numbers, these are transpositions. Yes, then you just fix the genus or the total number of cycles. Yeah. So if you do not distinguish the genus, then you're right that the answer is just obvious. So the main thing is the distribution between different genera. So for the case of maps, map or ribbon graph, or fair graph. If you know, this is actually also, they could be encoded, the embedded graph to a surface. They could be encoded also by permutations. So again, we have similar permutation, triple of permutations. So in this case, we have just two permutations, phi and epsilon. And again, we impose this fixed number of cycles in this phi and epsilon. And besides, one of them, say epsilon, is an involution without fixed points. Let me recall that if you have a map, then you consider just the set of half edges, the set of permuted elements are just half edges. Then the permutation sigma permutes half edges, permutates cyclically half edges around the vertices. The permutation epsilon exchanges half edges of one fixed edge. And phi corresponds to the faces. It acts on faces by permuting cyclically half edges along one each face. So this could be encoded by the map, every map could be encoded by just a triple of permutations. So in this situation, epsilon has specific form of a transposition without fixed points. So the case of hypermaps. Just an embedded graph to a surface. In geographic sense. So this is a map, and for hypermap, so is this just generalization of the situation of maps, which is we have no restriction on epsilon. So there are maps with generalized edges that could have many legs. They also have a combinatorial description in terms of bipartite maps and so on. So it happens that in all these versions, the situation is just the same. So if you compose the corresponding number, if you organize the corresponding numbers into generic functions, then again we have the same property that it is satisfies KP equations of KP hierarchy. Moreover, there is an explicit formula for this function, which says as follows. Since we act in the permutation group, that we can apply machinery of representation theory for permutation group. And actually, this could be reformulated as a certain problem of enumeration, of computing certain structure coefficients in the algebra, in the group algebra of the symmetric algebra, and moreover in its center. So this could be formalized in the following character formula. So the left hand side could be written quite explicitly as a sum of permutation. So here, by definition, I write the function in the monomial basis. So the corresponding numbers are Taylor coefficients of the Taylor coefficients of monomial expansion. So here I use a different expansion in terms of Schur functions, and this formula expresses the coefficients of this expansion. Schur functions form another basis, additive basis in the space of polynomials in p variables, so we can just consider these two expansions as just different expansion of in different additive basis in the corresponding algebra of power series. So the coefficients here is the following. First of all, we have some extra factor that I denote this way, where Q, for simplicity, for a moment I put just this sequence of variables. And this number is equal to the dimension of reducible representation lambda divided by the number of permuted elements factorial, the order of symmetric group. And here there is one particular interesting factor, which is a so-called content product. So given a permutation, given a Young diagram, consider sum of its cell, which has coordinates I and J. And by definition, the content of the cell with coordinates I and J is just the difference. So on the diagonal, we have zeros. Then we have ones, two, and so on, minus one, and so on. So we have n numbers associated with the Young diagram, which are contents of the cells. So this product is over all cells. And here we have certain values of certain series phi on the content of this cell. Besides, this expression. On? Yeah. No, phi is a universal. I will show. I will explain what is lambda, what is phi. Yeah, it's a series. So, what's one more remark that I have the variable h here responsible for the genus expansion. And at the moment, there is no h in this formula. So, the actual actual insertion of H is governed by the Riemann-Hurwitz formula, and this should be as follows. So here I divide every variable by the first power of H, and here I multiply the content by H. So in this way, this is a well-defined series. Otherwise, its evaluation, the final point, is not defined. So in this way, it's a well-defined series. So what's phi? Yeah, I will comment this.
Where the initial V.
this is a, there is a slightly alternative viewpoint to the KP hierarchy. Usually, in the classical approach, KP hierarchy is considered as a evolution in the space of functions in the one, the first space coordinate with respect to the times. So here there is no distinction between the
first and second.
So here we do not distinguish between. So we do not distinguish between variables. There is no distinction between time and space variables. We do not consider this as an evolution equation. So you can you can restrict to. Yeah. Phi is different. I will comment this. So let me just say what is phi.
It's just a function of a single variable.
Yeah.
It's not
the whole the space of solutions, just a particular solution. So here these are examples of this function phi. So this is we have an infinite sequence of examples of the solutions to the KP hierarchy. And there is one more thing that I have not mentioned up to this moment. So I speak here about the ordinary Hurwitz numbers and their variations, which corresponds to the specification of the variable Q is just 1, 0, 0, 0. So this expression is symmetric in P and Q, but I consider P as just the variables and Q are additional parameters. So in this case, I just consider ramification of a rim and sphere with prescribed ramification at infinity and certain degenerations at the finite points. There is a version of this theory where we have considered two complicated ramification points, say over zero and over infinity. And also we have complicated ramification of this point, which is now given by two partitions, lambda and mu. So this is the case of double Hurwitz numbers. So if we encode, and all other ramification points are simple. So if we encode this kind of numbers into generating function, then we should introduce two sets of variables. One set of variables is responsible for ramification at infinity, and another set of variables will correspond to ramification over zero. So when we have no ramification, then we have just partition 1, 1, 1, 1, which just corresponds to the variable Q1 non-zero and the remaining zero. So in general, we could consider any variable Q which correspond to any possible ramification over zero. Yeah, you're right. Right. So it will actually tau function of total hierarchy. But for a moment, I just consider Q1, Q0, but it does not have a specific meaning in this. They are obtained from this one by rescaling, by simple rescaling by certain factor. They are essentially given by zero charge function. So this one is a zero charge, and for other charges, it's just small rescaling. Yeah. I will explain the reason for that. Yes. So I will explain this. So just let me finish the definition. So we have ordinary, but we have also the case of generalized double Hurwitz numbers in all this series when we have one extra ramification at infinity. And also, it's quite possible to fix that we have an infinity at infinity all points of ramified with the same order. So we have here ramification something like k, 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 and so on, partition of this sort. This corresponds to so-called orbifold Hurwitz numbers. So this is exactly the situation for the case of maps. We have one ramification with partition 2, 2, 2, 2. It corresponds to this situation. And in general, we have a series phi, which is just 1 plus some formal power series. And also the Q variables could be encoded in a series Q. Just the corresponding data ramification over zero is encoded into this series Y. So in all these cases, we have Y of Z is equal to Z. So now let me explain this phenomenon that this series indeed a KP is related to KP hierarchy. So I will present a viewpoint to the theory of KP hierarchy, which is slightly. No, just formal series. We have. No. When I insert the h parameter, and I have it just expansion in terms of h. Yeah.
But in all these cases, it's
convergent. In all these cases, it's convergent. You're right.
In general.
No need.
Why V is sort of a set of coordinates for KP? Why this big Y, it appears nowhere.
Nowhere. It's just the way to encode this Q. I will need it later.
But still, what is, you say that everywhere on the right part of the left platform, so you have Q being 1000, yeah? Or in the last case, it's different.
Yeah, so this is Z and this is Z squared. Yeah.
And why is that equal to that square?
This is just because in the case of maps. Oh, sorry, the case of maps. the case of maps, if you remember, there was a part, there was a permutation which is a, in my definition of maps, there was a permutation which is an involution without fixed points. So it has cyclic type 2, 2, 2, 2. So it corresponds to this. Yeah. Yeah. So this is Q. So you can even think that this is a, what's written here is a family of Kp tau functions depending on these two formal power series, or just Ck and Qm could be treated as a formal parameters. And this is the so-called Orlov Sherbin family. It appeared in the paper of Orlov and Sherbin, and for just different reason, but it happens that most of the functions in the Hurwitz theory are just specification of this particular one. So now let me give you some brief account of the theory of Kp hierarchy, which probably is slightly different from the one which is a classical one. However, what I'm going to say is quite known, but I will just change a little bit the accents. So consider the space of power series in P variables, which is called boson Fock space of charge zero, and all tau functions are elements of this boson Fock space. And in this space, there is a subspace of those functions which are tau functions of Kp hierarchy. So instead of describing the equations of the hierarchy, it happens that it's much easier and much more affordable to describe the space of solutions, the space of tau functions. So this situation is similar to the case of in the algebraic geometry in the theory of Grassmannians. So everyone knows what is Grassmannian. It's a collection of subspaces in finite dimensional space of fixed dimensions. However, we know that Grassmannian could be embedded by Plucker embedding to the projective space and could be described by Plucker equations. So imagine a textbook in algebraic geometry where the chapter for devoted to Grassmannian starts with the following definition. Grassmannian is algebraic variety given by the following list of equations. And then you have the list of Plucker equations. This is more or less what happens here. So there is a main object. There is a basic object, the space of tau functions, which is very nice, very geometric, and quite easy to explain. And in particular, they could be determined by the set of equations, and those are Kp equations. But the basic object is the space of solutions rather than the space of functions. So what, for instance, what's nice here? Yeah. So formal solutions.
Is just pure
formal solutions, right.
When you're dealing with waves
in plasma, no, just formal solutions. No. Of course, well, don't take my words too seriously, right. But what's nice, for instance, here, there is a huge group of symmetries acting on this space of solutions. The corresponding group, there is a huge group of symmetries which acts in the boson space. And this group is so big that the whole space of solutions form a one orbit. So every tau function could be obtained from anyone by applying a suitable element of this group. So let me, for instance, explain what's written in this formula. I start with a function 1. So lemma, function equal constant function 1 is a tau function. Yeah, because all partial derivatives are 0. Then we apply certain transformation. It happens that the operator of multiplication by pi is also denoted as ai. It's acting on the Fock space, and this is an element of Lie algebra. So it follows that if you apply the exponent of this operator, you obtain an element of Lie group. So every function of this sort is a tau function. You just applied certain element of this group. So the result of this will be this expansion without this content product term. This is a well-known identity for Schur functions. Then the next, we should apply this operator. Insert these factors. So these factors, they rescale Schur functions. So this is a certain operator for which Schur functions are eigenvectors. So this is a so-called certain operator, which is a just diagonal operator the operator sending every Schur function to the exponent, to the corresponding product, content product. And this one happened to be also an element of this group of symmetries. So from the very formula, from the very existence formula, we get that the result is a tau function. So to be more concrete, the corresponding group, the corresponding Lie algebra and Lie group, are the groups of transformations of some infinite dimensional vector space. So if we denote by Eij the corresponding matrix unit, so then we have that this Lie algebra is generated by the matrix unit elements, and Ij run over the basic vectors of this additional vector space. It's also actually infinite, and its basic elements are labeled by integer, or it's traditional to label it by half integers. And besides, we have this hat, which means that we also add a scalar operator. And this is just certain one-dimensional central extension of the corresponding group of linear transformations. So the corresponding commutation of this EIJ is the same as commutation is in the space of matrices up to a constant. And so in this case, this WIJ, W is an element of the corresponding. This is a Lie algebra, and W is an element of Lie group, which also could be written in this way. It's a diagonal matrix. And on the diagonal, we have certain value, eigenvalue WI, such that WI plus 1/2 over WI minus 1/2 is just P of J minus I, like that. Phi I, right. So I is a integer, this index half integer, so this here we have elements labeled by half integers. So by definition, by construction, this is an element of the same space of solutions. Oh, for a moment, okay. For a moment, let phi will be convergent, because in this description I ignore the genus expansion. So let me put h bar equal to 1, and phi will be just.
So W is basically some product of this
phi from some. Yeah, yeah. So I defined up to a common factor, so everything defined up to a scalar, which acts actually trivially. Just diagonal transformation by definition. No. These are invertible. Yeah, these are invertible, right. These are invertible elements. W's are invertible. Yeah, I treat this an element of the of Lie group. So actually, for the rest, I do not need any explanation why this does hold. So let me just give you a small the actual explanation, the how this action of this Lie algebra appears and how these operators act in the boson-Fock space, could be understood in terms of so-called boson-fermion correspondence. I should go to fermionic Fock space, but probably the audience knows this better than me, so I will not discuss this anymore. So let me just fix this fact that you have a huge number of very nice differential operators acting in the bosonic Fock space, and these operators have very nice commutation relations, the same commutation relations as in the space of matrices, and exponents of these operators preserves KP solutions, KP tau functions. So we have a lot of examples and convenient way to produce solutions, formal solutions to KP hierarchy. And we have a lot of a way to construct a lot of solutions without writing a single equation of their hierarchy itself.
Well,
Okay. Now the next step, I wish to discuss another interesting feature of the Hurwitz functions, namely the so-called topological recursion. This is another nice concept that appears quite often recently. It's a fashionable stuff. So in this case of Hurwitz functions, it's quite easy to observe what it is. So I used power series to pack Hurwitz numbers into generating functions. There is another way to pack them as follows. Yeah? Yeah.
Is it the same as to say that it's just a fine Grassmannian?
Yes.
It's not a fine Grassmannian, it's called standard Grassmannian. So it's virtual. It's much simpler than a fine
Grassmannian. It's a Grassmannian, or rather an open cell in this Grassmannian, but you're right. And this Grassmannian, of course, the Grassmannian is the group of linear transformations acts on any Grassmannian, in particular in Sato Grassmannian, and of course it's transitive. So you're right. So there is a different way to pack Hurwitz numbers into generating series as follows. I fix G and N and consider those I consider those Hurwitz numbers for which the genus is fixed and the length of the partition is fixed. And I put here x1 to the power of lambda 1, xn to the power of lambda n. This is just an alternative way to collect these numbers into generating series. So the difference is that we have different collection of variables for different n. So in the original presentation, we have just single set of variables, and the indices, the components of the partition corresponds to the indices of variables pi. Here we have the corresponding exponents. So in the same way, we could write this as the following certain differential operator applied to the corresponding component of the Hurwitz function. So let me consider the Hurwitz function and consider its sum and correspondent to the fixed genus and homogeneity degree. So this HGN contains only those monomials which have length n. So here delta I is an operator which transforms p variables to the x variables. Anyway, this is just an alternative way to collect functions into generating series. So even for small g and n, this is a huge infinite series. And the main observation is the following. So principle, or the idea that there exists change of variables . So instead of xi, we pass to the variables zi, which are related by certain change of variables, such that wgn becomes rational. And so it follows that it could be given for each particular GNN, it could be given in a closed form. The corresponding change of variables has the name, it's called spectral curve. The spectral curve, equation of the spectral curve, is just the equation of this mysterious change of variables. Actually, let me write it in this way. It's given by parametrization. X is equal to z over phi of y of z. So this is a change of variables, and y is just y of z. This is the equation of spectral curve. So this, the first equation is just this mysterious change of variables, which makes function of real, rational. So of course, right. So this is x of z, and since phi starts with 1, so this is invertible at the origin. So I consider the inverse function denoted by z, and this is the corresponding change of variables. Or I just put this substitution to this series, and this becomes a power expansion of a rational function. So, in fact, to be precise, I need to assume that y and phi are, say, polynomials, or actually, what we need. Is a rational function, is rational one form. So let me give you an example. For the case of the basic example is just the simple Hurwitz numbers. In this case, we have y of z is just equal to z. Phi of z is equal to exponent of z.
The function phi is different from what had
appeared already. No, the one, exactly. Exactly this function. So the equation x is equal to z exponent of minus z. Then dx over x is equal to Is that correct? Something like that. No. Weinmann.
Vice versa.
Vice versa. Right. So, for instance, assertion, proposition, or one of the examples, consider W03, which is just a quite big series in X1, X2, and X3, the infinite series, but it happens that in this particular case, it collapses to just Z1, Z2, Z3. Which is quite amazing. Oh, sorry, problem. Yes, write that, like that. So let me write. Okay. So it happens probably. Let me write in this particular case. So z x of z is equal to z to the power exponent minus z. It's a not so complicated to invert the series. And the inverse series is given by the power expansion sum of x to the power n, n to the power n minus 1, or n factorial, like that. Yeah. So I'm sorry. I'm slightly cheating. It's slightly more complicated, but not so much. Yes. And 1 over 1 minus z is equal to 1 plus sum x to the power n to the power n divided by n factorial x to the power m. So if you have really product of three functions, which you, when you expand, you obtain a quite complicated infinite series, but it could be written in this simpler way. So in all other cases, these functions are also rational. There is certain recursive procedure to write them one by one. I will explain something more.
Do they all factorize?
No. So what's interesting here, that this function has poles at the point zi to the equal to I. Let me consider this change of variables written here. X and z. It looks something like so at the origin it's just a local change of coordinates, and we need this local change of coordinates at the origin. But there is another point which is not seen at the x coordinate, because it corresponds to x equal to E inverse and the corresponding z equal to 1. So it happens that our function, our rational function, has poles with respect to each variable at this point. And this point is quite far from the origin. Moreover, when you consider the x expansion, you do not see this point, because the radius of convergence is exactly this, equal to E inverse. So this point can be seen only when you make this change of coordinates and pass to the rational expression for the WGM. So let me make more properties of this WGM. Concerning this particular situation, it is given by this exact explicit formula. So moreover, has poles at z equal to pi, where pi are critical points of the function f, which is the same as zeros of dx over x. So dx over x is treated as a global meromorphic differential form on the spectral curve. This is a, we consider spectral curve as just CP1 with affine coordinate z, and x is just a local coordinate at the origin. And when you extend x, you treat it as a rational function, or just as a meromorphic form of this combination is a well-defined meromorphic form. And we look at the zeros. No. Let me denote this another way. P capital I. This is the point P. So let me explain now what topological recursion says. It's a quite a big expression, explicit expression, but what's the meaning of this expression? We had a seminar talk of Dunin-Barkovsky. He wrote this formula for the topological recursion. And if you open any paper on topological recursion, you will observe this formula, which occupies several lines. And the meaning of this formula is unclear. The idea of the formula is as follows. So we can consider this WGM. And we know that it is a rational function with respect to z1 as a function in z1. We know that it is rational. And we know the position of its poles. So if you know the poles, and if you know the principal parts of poles, then we can recover the function uniquely, right? It's a rational function. So we know the function. So recursive formula of topological recursion, on the right-hand side, you have not the W itself, but only the expression for the principal part of the poles from the smaller values of g and n. So the procedure goes as follows. You put this recursive formula, you compute principal part of the poles of WGN at all poles
in
it's a in n variables, but I consider just the first variable, and the remaining variables are just look at them as the parameters. No, in this recursion formula, the variable Z1 has a special role. So this the recursive formula is not symmetric. No, the result is by chance is symmetric function. You're right. Yeah. So you know principal part, if you know the principal part of the poles, then you can recover the function itself. And the recursion provides the principal part of the poles. So it's amazing that the rationality property is implemented in the topological recursion. We need actually what we need at the end. We need the expansion at the origin. But in order to obtain its origin, we first extend this as a global rational function, then compute principal part of the poles, then recover the function, and then again restrict to the origin to get the Taylor coefficients. Well, at infinity, it depends on the situation. Sometimes you may assume that there is no pole at infinity. So here there is no pole at infinity. So let me give the last detail. So consider a critical point of the function x. And assume that all critical points are simple. So there is a Morse function, so it's a locally double ramified covering. Then there is an involution. It's written here. So the differential is meromorphic. So zeros and critical points are rational. Logarithm x is a differential. Differential of logarithm is meromorphic. Yes. Yeah. This is the Yes, you're right. So for this, So at the moment I assume that it is that it's meromorphic. Yes. So let me. I will give a general statement slightly later. So, let me give one more detail. So consider a critical point, and there is an involution exchanging branches of the function x. It's a homomorphic involution which is defined in the neighborhood of this point P. So it happens that principal part of the poles is odd with respect to this involution. Now, probably I will write the relation of topological recursion. At, with respect to each variable, but in particular with respect to Z1. W of Z1 plus W of sigma of Z1 is holomorphic. So the actual relation looks as follows. First of all, instead of this W, one uses so-called correlator differential, which is a write by small W, which is D1, Dn, W, Gn. Just differentiate with respect to each of the variables, so it's a one form with respect to each Zi. Then relation looks as follows. If you like, write Wgn Gn, right? And let me denote the k is the set of indices. So on the right hand side, for small w, you write the following ansatz. So you write w g, g minus 1 n plus 1 of zk plus sum over all possible g1 plus g2 is equal to g, n1 plus n2 equal to n plus 1, w, k is equal to I union j, w of g1 plus 1 Zi W G2 G plus 1 Zj. So this expression happened to be quadratic differential with respect to Z. Right. It happens to be equivalent to Virasoro constraint. Right. Wait a minute. So y dx over x. So y plus sigma of y. What part of the sigma, something like that. So when you write this expression, I put here the odd part of the function y at the origin. Therefore, the right-hand side is defined only in the neighborhood of each point pi, not globally. It's defined only in the neighborhood of this point. So it takes this expansion, and it happens that the left-hand side and the right-hand side do not agree. But what is the same is just principal part of the pole. The difference of the left-hand side in the right hand side is holomorphic. Fig in Z1 at Z1 PI. So this expression determines only the principal part of the pole. At Z, right, Z. And actually, one should, it's almost one more detail, so W02 of Z1 should be corrected. I will not go into details. So indeed, if you look at the, if you compare the Taylor coefficients on the left hand side and on the right hand side of the, at the pole, at the point of the pole, you will observe that indeed these coefficients are partial derivatives of the original, of the original potential. So it follows that this is again indeed relation which relates second order partial derivatives and product of the first order partial derivatives of original potential. And this is exactly Virasoro constraints. So this funny expression is just some sophisticated way to write the Virasoro constraints. Yeah, like that. Yeah, Virasoro constraint, constraints associated with the branch points. You have a series labeled by non-negative integers for each of pi. So there are certain, I didn't look carefully, but there are certain computations related to matrix models when they use spherical curves of higher genus, and they have to fix also this values of periods.
This is single part of fractions one.
Yeah, they fix periods and then so let me give the last so what I said before is somehow theory which is distributed between dozen of papers and a lot of people who contributed to this stuff, starting from Inaro Rantens and Chekhov, who originated topological recursion, and then many people work in this area. So this is somehow common point. But recently I made some computer experiments supporting the following conjecture. So my claim is the following. So in this particular situation of generalized Hurwitz numbers, this WGN can be written as a formal formal rational expression in this phi of y of zi and what else, and y of zi and their derivatives. And these are functions in one variable, so we take just their derivatives. So it depends on g and n. So for each g and n, there is a finite expression, sometimes quite huge, but it's finite. What's interesting? Yeah.
No, I mean, the previous recursion regulations, they should start with n equals, with n bigger than 3, and w1 and 2.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a certain starting point of this W03 and W11 starting initial condition for this recursion. So what's...
So you say that WGN is WGN.
Yeah.
And so it's a function of this
variables. Yeah. No, now I say that there is a...
you have full expression for the whole function.
I have full expression for the whole function, where I do not assume neither rationality nor the simplicity of the poles. So just formal expression, I can substitute whatever to this expression, and it holds even in the for infinite formal series. And... yes, I have a computer program which produces this, and not so big for W03, W04, W05, W11, W12, W21, something not slightly more, but then my computer, the program is universal, but the ability of
computer
is not. Yeah, that's right. Okay, there are
shared facilities.
So what's? Let me say how it works. So I have H zero is W exponent of sum of pi qi, qi pi over I one is like that. So I have lemma. D over dpi of one is equal to zero. It happens that this lemma is quite non-trivial, because I consider this tau function 1, and I apply an element of GL infinity. So it means that this tau function has a huge group of symmetries, of centralizers quite big. We have a big centralizer, a lot of operators which preserve this point. Indeed, every plane in the Grassmannian had a lot of transformations which preserve this plane in the Grassmannian. Now, I change the tau function, so it means that I conjugate this operator by this one. And I get a lot of operators which annihilate my function h. So I have a procedure to produce a lot of operators which annihilate this function. So for instance, this one produces equations on h0 which could be treated as a Virasoro. And this is like that. Then I translate these equations in terms of WGN, and then solution, iterative solution to this equation produces produces this WGN. So in this procedure, I need to somehow to integrate differential equations, differential expressions in these two, in these functions. And it's not always the fact that if you have differential expression, that primitive also of the same form. But according to my experiments, up to this point, everything worked correctly, so I can recover all this WGN.
Can you give a
hint
just
for W03? What kind of form? Okay. W03. This Fubini-Trudy type. Phi of z minus z over q of z, z1, phi of z2 minus z2 over q of z2, phi of z3 minus z3 over q of z3, z1 squared, z1, z2 squared, z2, z3 squared, z3, zj, and q of z is 1 minus minus z phi strip prime of z phi prime of y of z. So dx over x is equal to x z phi of y of z q of z. Oh, just x d z over dx one of dx over x, right, q of z dz z phi of dz, like that.
So you see that this expression for W is to be for any y of z and
y of z. Z1, z2, z3. Yeah.
So this expression for any phi of z.
Yes, yes, yes. It's just in this closed form, yeah. So the pole along the diagonal will cancel if you substitute particle phi. So it's a regular with respect to each variable. The only pole are just zeros of q, which are the same as critical points of x. And this expression holds formally without any assumption on the series phi. Yeah, yeah, a lot of experiments.
In this framework, the meaning of spectral curve, is it true that you just assuming that you have this Grassmannian in a formal disk, and you suppose that it's not a formal disk, but is essentially a part of the expansion of something on a curve? Otherwise, what is this spectrum?
I wouldn't say so. So it's not like in your, it's not like this in this situation. So in our curve, in our case, the term spectral curve somehow speculative because I have no operator, no spectral system, nothing like that. So the only thing that the first corollary of my computation is just the function. I start with the function W01 of x d over dx, which I denote y of x. And it happens that after some computation, you find that it satisfies implicit functional equation just y of x phi of y is equal to y. And then this is just formal computation. And then you speculate and call this equation just spectral curve. So it's just the result of computation in our particular case. So the for this kind of formulas you do not require anything, and this is also just a local change at the origin. This, in my context, this is just equality of formal expansion at the origin. But if by chance phi and q are rational, then it's a global equality of rational functions. So, but at the moment, this is developing and have very, very peculiar computer experiments, and so it's very interesting. So thank you. Sure. Забирайте, а то мне...